This is my 3-in-1 mill lathe combo machine the day I uncrated it. They say you can't polish a turd, and with all the improvements I've made to this machine, it has quite a shine. If that saying is true, that must mean it was not a turd to begin with. Greetings, fellow DIYer, and welcome to my video. So you may be wondering why I would spend all the time and money to upgrade a Harbor Freight 3-in-1 mill lathe combo machine instead of just buying a bigger, better machine. Well, the answer is simple. Even if I did get a newer, nicer machine, it would still need to be upgraded. So by investing time and money into what I have, I can make it exactly the way I want it. Also, in the future, if I do get a newer, nicer machine, I can transfer these upgrades to that machine.
I've done a lot of modification, as you can see, and most of the individual projects have their own video. So as I'm going over these projects in my top 10 video, I will link the individual video that has a lot more details about the specific project.
And now the list you've all been waiting for, coming in at number 10, upgrading to 5-inch chucks.
This machine came with a 4-inch chuck, and I upgraded to both a 3-jaw and a 4-jaw 5-inch chuck, and this vastly opened up my ability to hold work. Obviously, the 4-jaw chuck will hold things that are irregular shape, and having that extra inch made all the difference in the world. I can fit a lot bigger material and work on a lot bigger projects.
Number 9, a column filled with lead.
So this column is filled with lead and weighs 100 pounds. When I removed the mill head, I noticed that this machine started to chatter a whole lot more when I was turning things on the lathe. Makes sense. The smaller a machine, usually the more prone it is to chatter. And a lot of that has to do with mass. By removing the 70-pound mill head, my chatter got a whole lot worse. So I welded up this box, poured lead into it, and then capped it off. When I installed it, I found that my machine was less prone to chatter than it had been when the mill head was still attached. So it goes to prove the more mass a machine has, the less likely it is to chatter.
Number 8, larger, more free-spinning hand wheels.
So this is the replacement wheel that I added to this machine. It's a 6-inch wheel and it has a free spinning handle. And that replaced this right here, which was a 5-inch wheel. And it was just a stud that had a sleeve rotating on it. You can see I got a lot of use out of this. The chrome is worn off and the copper is starting to show through. Much happier with the 6-inch wheel, gives me a little better control and the free spinning handle. I also put a 6-inch hand wheel on the main lead screw.
Number 7, a spindle lock.
So right here we have the spindle lock. You use it pretty simply. You just tighten this up. As it begins to tighten, you slide the safety in front of the power switch so that you're not accidentally turning it on while it's locked. And that securely locks the spindle in place. And then to loosen it up, you just do everything in reverse. Let that swing in front. Take the tension out. And now the spindle spins freely.
Number 6, a solid tool post.
So this machine came with this compound and it works very well. It's a nice compound. It's great for threading. It's great for cutting tapers. But with this being such a small machine, I wanted to increase rigidity. Anything you can do to make things more stable, more rigid, the better cuts you're going to get. So I fabricated up this solid tool post to eliminate the compound. Most of the time when I'm making cuts, I use this unless I have specific need of the compound.
Number 5, a quick change tool post.
Originally from the factory, mounted onto the compound was this turret style tool post. It worked fairly well. It spins and then you lock it down with this knob. So you could put a tool here and a tool here so that you just rotated it and tightened it down. The problem is there was no height adjustment. And so that's why I decided to get a quick change tool post.
This is the wedge style quick change tool post that I purchased. And there were a few challenges to getting it installed. First of all, this hole is 14 millimeter and the original mounting on the compound was 16 millimeter. It was an easy fix. I got myself a 16 millimeter bolt, chucked it up into the lathe, turned it down to 14 millimeter, and then threaded it for a cap nut. When I built my solid tool post, I just simply tapped this for 9/16 and it bolts the quick change tool post down. Number four, a DRO.
This machine has a DRO, a fantastic upgrade. It has also improved my machining skills. I had to fabricate brackets to mount the scales to both axes on the machine. On the back, I had to use a piece of angle iron to mount it to the base of the feet of the machine, and then I could attach the scale to it. On the cross slide, I also had to use a piece of steel to attach it to the cross slide and then attach the scales to it.
Number three, separating my 3-in-1 machine into two individual machines.
So this is my standalone mill made from the mill head of my 3-in-1 combo machine. I built the base and attached a import cross slide table to it. And then I put a DRO on this as well. And then that's my power supply there in the back, because this is getting powered with a treadmill motor, just like the lathe. I also added power feed to this, but the reality of it is this is such a small table that power feed is nice to have, but it's not something that I use all that often. And then it came with 4-inch wheels, and I upgraded to the 6, same as the lathe on both axes.
Number two, ELS.
So these are the pieces that make threading possible. This is the readout for the ELS. If I'm using it as power feed, this is where I set my speeds and feeds. If I'm threading, this is where I put in the thread count, that kind of thing, whether it's metric, imperial. Then we come down to the encoder. This is driven off the spindle and it tells the system how fast the spindle is spinning. I'm going to come back to the speed control here. Having this fine control and being able to turn the speed way down makes it a whole lot easier to do threading. Then down here we have the clutch mechanism and the stepper motor. This is the stepper motor that drives the lead screw when I am threading. And this is the clutch that I designed and built that allows me to connect and disconnect the lead screw from the stepper motor. So when I'm turning things by hand, or if I'm trying to pick up a thread, that kind of thing, I can disconnect it. And then down here we have the main power box. This has all the Clow 42 electronics inside and allows me to hook up my ELS. This is my autonomous power feed. Now, the Clow 42 ELS has power feed, but it's 100% dependent on what the spindle is doing. And I wanted the ability to not have it be dependent on what the spindle is doing, so that I could adjust speed, turn it on, turn it off, that kind of thing. So this is a stepper driver. This is the on-off. This is the speed control. And this is the direction. And I have this switch down here. It's currently in the thread mode for the Clow 42 ELS. When I put it up, it goes into the autonomous power feed mode. So we can turn it on. And you can see that stepper motor is spinning. And I can just pop the clutch. And everything is spinning and the power feed is working. And I can turn up the speed. Turn it off, switch directions, turn it on. And you can see it feeding.
And number one, the upgrade that has made the most improvement to this machine, a variable speed treadmill motor so that I can go anywhere from 50 to 1500 RPMs with the turn of a couple knobs.
This is the control panel for my lathe. When I first got the lathe, there was only one switch there, and it had reverse, off, and forward. And that was it. That was the only options. Now I have coarse speed adjustment, fine speed adjustment, master power, and then this is my direction control. So if we turn that on, and turn it off with the direction control. There's neutral in the middle, and that's it going the opposite direction. So that's my treadmill motor. It's 3 horsepower at 4,000 RPM. I have it using the original pulleys that came with the lathe, and I have it set on the slowest setting. So what used to be 500 RPMs on this machine is now anywhere between 50 and 1500 RPM just by turning the dial. I absolutely love this upgrade using this treadmill motor. Hands down, this is number one, and I couldn't be happier with the results of doing this upgrade.
So you may look at this list, especially the top four, a DRO, separating it into two machines, ELS, and wonder why the treadmill motor is the number one upgrade. Well, that's pretty simple. The treadmill motor upgrade gave me variable speed, and it was variable speed that allowed me to install the ELS. I would not be able to thread at 500 RPMs, which was the minimum speed before this upgrade. And it was the treadmill motor that allowed me to separate this into two individual machines, because the mill is also powered by a treadmill motor.
If you like what you've seen, please click like. If you'd like to see more, please subscribe. Thanks for watching. So there's my 3-in-1 mill lathe combo as it looks today. But wait, where's the mill head? Oh, I found it. Good.